Hi, welcome to Beyond Science Initiative 2017. My name is Samuel Ahuno, and I'm presenting on the topic, the role of treatment options and host immune response in the killing of filaria nematode parasites. So filaria infections are caused by tissue-dwelling nematode parasites. So depending on the type and location of the adult worm, they may elicit one of the following infections, namely lymphatic filariasis, onchocerciasis, loasis, mantonellosis. Now, these are diseases of poverty and affect approximately 200 million people worldwide. It's interesting that these diseases are also ranked the second most common cause of physical disability. These infections are basically prevalent in developing countries, especially in Africa, some parts of Asia, and then South America. So this table illustrates the various types of filaria parasites, the location of the adult worms, the vectors responsible for the transmission of these parasites, and then some of the clinical symptoms and diseases they elicit. So the first bar illustrates the first bar. In the first bar, we have three major parasites responsible for erythematous lymphatic filariasis. The adult worms usually reside in the lymphatics, and then they are able to elicit erythematous lymphedema, and then hydrocele fever, and others. So the vectors responsible for transmission are the Anopheles and Culex mosquito. The second section, we have parasites where the adult worms reside in the subcutaneous tissue. So we could have onchocerciasis, varroa, and then mansonella. So you might have heard of river blindness in some parts of Africa. So the onchocerciasis volvulus is responsible for river blindness. And then we have the simulin black flies as vectors responsible for the transmission of this parasite. So this illustrates some of the pathologies associated with lymphatic filariasis. The first two illustrates lymphedema, and in the third one, that's the C, illustrates the advanced form of hydrocele, that's the swelling of the scrotal sacs, the male genitalia. So these are also some pathologies associated with onchocerciasis. We normally have the nodules being formed on infected individuals, and then skin lesions, you could have dermatitis, and then some have the advanced sclerosing keratitis being formed. So there is compelling evidence that the clearance of this parasite is not only done by anti-helminthic drugs. In fact, the host immune response play a major role, or a complementary role in the clearance of this infection. So this study kind of, for the first time, compares the drugs which are being used for treating filariasis on one hand, and then on the other hand, we have the activities of the host immune response. So this is the first time we are kind of comparing both strategies or both paradigms in the clearance of the infection. So the treatment options, it's basically chemotherapy, usually through mass drug administration. And then one of the drugs we use is ivermectin. Ivermectin is able to interact with the postsynaptic glutamate gated chloride channels of the worms, therefore resulting in the paralysis of this worm. It's interesting to note that these targeted proteins are encoded in the genome of nematodes and arthropods, therefore restricting the activities of the drug to organisms belonging to this phylum. So microfilaria adults are thus transported to the regional lymph nodes where they are acted upon by the effector cells. There are also some discrepancies with the activity. activity of abamectin. So some studies also show weak activity of the drug, therefore emphasizing the role of the host immune response in controlling these parasites. So you must note that one of the important causes for different immune responses against abamectin is the genetic background of the host. So gene polymorphism, particularly in cytokine genes associated with either immunosuppression to oncocytosis or protection, may contribute to varying therapeutic success of abamectin in different parasite hosts. The second type of drug is what we term as the albendazole. Albendazole is quite common. It's also effective against flatworms, nematodes, and cestodes. Works by inhibiting the polymerization of the worm beta tubulin and then and also microtubule formation. This drug, albendazole, has also been reported to increase compliance to mass drug programs because of its direct effects on other gastrointestinal ailments. The third class of drugs is what we term as the diethylcarbamazine. So they are the most effective drugs against human filaria infections because they are able to attack the parasites at all stages of its life cycle. So it's able to target the adult worm and both the baby worms. And it's also effective against other nematode parasites like hookworm and aster. So DEC has an indirect host-mediated mode of action along with anti-inflammatory effects during treatments. It inhibits the COX and lipo-oxygenase pathways of the parasites, resulting in the microfilaria death. So as we said earlier on, it is also effective against the adult worms and is able to elicit about 40% adult cider effect in some studies. Some studies have also suggested that the drug inhibits the nuclear transcription factor kappa B activation and a key regulator of pro-inflammatory genes such as TNF-alpha, IL-1 beta, as well as inducible nitric oxide synthesis and cyclooxygenase 2. So the drug also alters the arachidonic acid and nitric acid metabolic pathways, resulting in the immobilization and sequestration of these parasites that were yet to be elucidated. However, due to its severe adverse effects, the drug is not recommended for mass drug administration in non-post-sarcasis endemic areas where it may induce local inflammation in subjects with ocular endemic. So the next set of drugs is the doxycycline. Now, doxycycline is an anti-Wolbachia target. So the anti-Wolbachia has been shown to be essential for the growth and survival of most filarial worms. So this makes it a focus of an alternative therapy. So doxycycline has been demonstrated through field studies that is effective against adult worms and results in their elimination. However, there are contraindications among pregnant women and children under 9 years old. A study by Sharma and Taylor has recently been published, which shows that minocycline has a superior effect compared to doxycycline in murine studies. So these infections, filarial infections, are able to elicit both innate and adaptive immune response. So the elicit mainly the Th2 type immune response with increased production of interleukin 3, 4, 5, 9, 10, and 13. So infections are also characterized by increased production of IgG1, IgG4, and IgGE, and then expanded populations of eosinophils, basophils, mast cells, and then alternatively activated macrophages. So toll-like receptors have been also shown to be has been shown to also play a major role in the immune response against these worms. So this chart kind of summarizes the immune response to malaria parasites. So dendritic cells are able to present the antigens, which then induces the Th2 cell differentiation. Now, the Th2 cells are able to produce some cytokines, namely IL-4, 13, 3, 9, okay? And then an increased production of IL-13 will cause some downstream effects, which will finally lead to the production of, leads to the activation of eosinophils, alternatively activated macrophages, goblet cells, and then smooth muscles. So an increased production of IL-4 is able to also stimulate the downstream effect, which causes the production of alternatively activated macrophages, B cells, and then basophils, and then mast cells. Interestingly, the innate helper cells are able to receive signals from IL-25 and IL-33, and then these cells produces IL-13, which induces the downstream effects we spoke about previously. So the next section of these of this slide tries to bring out the roles of the effector cells. So the first one is eosinophils. Eosinophils has been shown to contribute to helminth destruction by antibody-dependent cytotoxicity. And then activated eosinophils release run proteins such as ribonuclease 2 and 3, eosinophils cationic proteins, major basic proteins, and eosinophil peroxidase. So eosinophils, interestingly, have been shown to be also essential for worm development. Try to bring the idea of the immunosuppression and regulatory rules of these helminths. The next type of cells we have, neutrophils. They control filaria nematodes in an IL-5 dependent matter. So in oncosequences, neutrophils are basically recruited to the site of infections and are influenced by the presence of Wolbachia endosymbiosis. So basophils are a key cell type in the initiation of Th2 immune response, since they are able to produce lots of IL-4. So depletion of basophils, some studies have shown that depletion of basophils results in a drastic destruction in eosinophils and CD4 T cell proliferation. So macrophages, Th2 cytokines such as IL-4, IL-13 induces what we term as the alternatively activated macrophages. So this is a scenario usually found in late infections. So AAMs are characterized by the expression of agonist 1, chitinase-like proteins, and resistin-like molecules, especially the alpha type. So AAMs contribute to tissue repair, immune regulation, and parasite control. So you can have, you can go to the paper by Quartin et al. For further reading, and then also check out Basil's paper on diversity and dialogue.